Alliances turn to ban. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Virtus Pros turn to ban. Alliances turn to pick.
Hello, hello. Is this thing on?
Virtus Pros turn.
All right, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Got another exciting best of one here in the European regional qualifiers for TI6. Dreams are going to come true very soon here, Merlini. Somebody's going to TI.
Who'd you have as your predictions? Did you put in predictions?
I didn't do predictions. Wow. I was on an airplane.
You had like 27 hours to do it.
I know.
You were not on an airplane for 27 hours. Shame on you.
I was on an airplane for a while, though. A third of it.
Shame on you.
Shame on me. All right. Alliance, Virtus Pro. Merlini, what are we thinking? Who's the favorite coming in here?
Alliance.
Alliance all the way?
Yeah.
All right.
Virtus Pro looked pretty shaky. Last time I saw them.
I agree. I was casting the Global Grandmasters tournament like 3 days ago, and I saw Adphenom just destroy VP in two games. It was like watching the NA Open Finals. It was just wiping the floor.
Mm. Yeah, that's about right.
But we'll see. Alliance, they've been a little hot and cold. I guess, honestly, we could have pulled up some standings here, talk about where what's on the line for these teams, but...
Go for it.
That was my cool way of asking you to do. Now Alliance did lose their first game against the Fantastic Five today, to a Luna Nightstalker, no less. So look out for that.
The nighttime buddies.
Yeah, it's a tough way to start their day, but they will get a pick that they're pretty comfortable with, the old Wisp.
And Virtus Pro immediately with two IO counters, soft counters.
Yeah, Witch Doctor with the bouncy coconut, Tidehunter. Yeah, okay. Is that really a counter to Wisp? I mean, it's pretty good.
It's a counter
Wisp.
Because most of his partners struggle a lot versus the Anchor Smash.
Okay, I see that.
Like, Tiny, like, if you get Anchor Smash, that's like minus 100 damage.
Right, okay. So, Bat Rider could be Bulldog in the off lane, could be S4 in the mid lane.
I don't think Alliance have really shifted away too much from their tried and true mid fighter for S4 and offlane farmer, so
Bulldog
I would say...
Bulldog does play it occasionally,
he does.
Okay.
I think it's more likely to be S4s, though.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. Does anybody else really play the mid Bat Rider right now? Somebody asked me that on the panel earlier, and S4 was the only person I could think of. Like, in recent history, of course.
Sumail has a little bit... I've seen some others, but it's just Dendi has.
Okay. Yeah, okay, I did see Dendi
it's
do it.
It's not common, though.
All right.
And none of them are as good as S4 in the mid lane. S4's Batrider is a tier above, I think, in the mid lane.
What is it about his Batrider that makes it so different? Is it just his ability to control the lane? Is it the rotations? Is it the itemization?
I think one part of it is that the team is so used to S4 fighting that they play really well around his fighting heroes, like Queen of Pain, Puck, Batrider in particular. Secondly, I don't know, he's just better.
He's just
it's weird, because Batrider has such a high skill cap.
Yeah.
You can definitely tell who's better and who's not. It's not like... I don't know. Tidehunter's like, okay, well, you got to stick Ravage.
Yeah, he knows the limits very well. That's one of the hardest things about Batrider early on, is like knowing, okay, he's got 4 stacks now. I can dive this tower and kill him before I'm going to die to auto attacks through the tower. It's like those kind of things where you're able to walk away one hit from death with the first blood under your belt.
I think the easiest way to put it for me is he's super confident. You can tell it with his Magnus play too. Like, if he sees an RP, he will go for it. He does not hesitate half a second. He just blinks in RPs instantly before teammates can react. Or
that's
his
true.
Opponents can
no,
react.
No, he definitely is a player that plays very much on, like, instinct. I've seen a couple of those, like, real clutch highlights from his stream where he's just like, I think they're going to initiate. Boom, hits the Zeus ult, and the Magnus just RPs himself because he was like... He's a very, when he has a gut instinct, he just goes for it. He doesn't hesitate. That's...
Yeah, he knows what's going to happen in teammates, so that's why I like his Batrider. Anyways, not that great versus Tidehunter, but it is the people like the one initiator so you can relocate. That is a very common thing. Used to be LC a little bit. Batrider's pretty good. Magnus is kind of a thing too. So you want those heroes that hard lockdown through BKB so you can relocate and kill people. It will be strong from 5 minutes until the end of the game.
I wonder what Wisp partner Alliance have in mind here. Tiny's obviously been banned out by VP.
Tiny's not that great versus Ty. I guess it's okay in lane. Tiny's good burst with Batrider too. What else is there? Chaos Knight's terrible. I'd say versus
Sven. I was gonna say Sven is what comes to mind.
Sven's always a thing. I think Sven's. Yeah, Sven's pretty good versus Tide too.
Decent against Witch Doctor, and yeah, I guess the God Strength kind of helps counteract the Anchor Smash.
It definitely does, and you can cleave him in lane if he like tries to go for creeps.
That's true.
It's a way to get around the Kraken Shell.
Yeah,
people like Gyro a lot too because Gyro is very good versus Tide. A lot of magic damage.
Man,
you build a lot of plus damage.
Shadow Demon picks, dude. He has totally come back in vogue. Secret just picked it up in the Vega game, is what I'm looking at, but.
Get your eyes on the prize. We have Alliance versus VP.
Hey, well, they could still pick Shadow Demon. It's food for thought.
They are one of the few teams that do pick Shadow Demon.
Yeah, they played it earlier, actually, in one of the games I was casting.
Yeah.
They also lost to it. Fantastic Five has picked it. There's been a Secret has picked it a number of times now.
He's kind of hot.
Mm-hmm.
He's on the rise.
We even saw a Shadow Demon get pulled up. That Fantastic Five game, and Alk pulled him in Ags. Which is kind of interesting. You don't see Shadow Demon Ags very often, but it's actually ridiculous now because you get the 3 charges, 40-second cooldown to replenish, and it has break.
Yep.
Good.
It is really good. One problem is you might not be able to get it.
Yeah, you need an Alchemist to farm it for you after he's already 6 slotted, but hey, if you can get that, you know, you're in pretty good shape.
Virtus Pro, what are they going to do?
They are really thinking about this.
We've seen Mass Team Fight before. Pace of Wood already banned out for them.
They've got to be thinking about Avenge. I mean, it's just that classic hero to deal with the Batrider. Okay, there it is.
All right. Easy.
I called one. Yay.
Easy.
It's a pretty straight-up counter. What about... All right, so one of the games that Ursa is a really good Wisp partner, because we don't see it very often, but occasionally it feels like Ursa is...
Oh, yeah. Ursa's good. I forgot about Ursa, just because teams haven't been picking him that much.
But, like, what are the ideal games when Ursa Wisp is better than, like, a Tiny Wisp or a Sven Wisp or something?
When he's not good at outlasting. Because he's all about, like
pop him, burst damage with his ult, and then run away. Is that what you mean by...
Well, not... You want to kill someone, like, instantly.
Yeah,
Like, Sven's really good at sustain damage. You just, okay. And he can tank up.
So Ursa's good at, like, you relocate, you pop all your stuff, you destroy one person, and then kind of reset the fight.
It's more like when they don't have mass team fight, but with all these voids, like Elder Titans, Tide Hunters popping up, Death Prophet, like, it's just really hard to... So I guess it will be a Bulldog bat.
Yeah.
With all these, like, mass team fight heroes, like, what does the Ursa do versus a Death Prophet? Like, you like, Spear Scythe into Ursa, you Yule yourself, and then, like, Ursa just kind of, like,
you can't do anything.
You can't do anything.
He just turns into a rug.
Yeah, if you're really farming, you can get, like, Diffusal and stuff like that, but even that doesn't prevent, like, a Yule onto the Ursa. Okay. So, like, just, there's a lot of popular heroes right now that just are extremely good versus the...
Well, speaking of popular heroes, we talked about it at the beginning of the last game, but Terra Blade has just been the talk of the tournament so far. I mean...
Our Alliance going to pick up an ET to try and deal with TB.
I don't think... Remember we talked about teams either love it or hate it, and so far, I don't think I've seen Alliance play too much ET.
No, they have not.
It's not really in their comfort zone.
It is not, but I think there are very few solutions to Terra Blade, and ET, I think, is just amongst the best.
I would say almost the best. I
mean, yeah.
Lion is burst damage is good. You know, Lion is a good support against him.
Probably the best. Yeah, you're right.
Who else is up there? I mean, compared to like Elder Titan, how much like armor he mitigates is ridiculous.
I think a void combo is really good versus him.
Okay. Yeah, just lockdown in general, though. I guess you can say lockdown's good against pretty much any hero.
No. You need AoE lockdown, or else his illusions will kill you.
Okay. Yeah. Well, there's the Lion, so that's another.
Yeah, Lion's much more stable.
Me? There we go.
Lion's very good at dealing with the illusions.
Oh yeah, he gets the mana thing, kills him instantly. You know, Slax was saying on the panel earlier, the counter to Terra Blade, Ag Scepter, Pugna. Just suck down all those illusions.
Yeah, it's been thought of before.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea, but you still need a Pugna with an Aghanim's, which is...
If you had an Elder Titan on your team, I think it'd be great, because Decrepify plus Natural Order is insane.
Oh,
but
yeah.
Then you already have a terrible counter.
Yeah, that's a good point. 10 seconds. Okay, so final bans here. Sven gonna be banned out by Virtus Pro, I think definitely warranted.
Yeah, Sven was the best one. Now what else is there?
Lark's already been banned. What else does Loda like to play these days? Gyrocopter's still in the pool.
I think Gyro's the best one.
Really? I was about to say, I think he's really fallen out of vogue.
No, he's the best one versus their lineup.
Versus their lineup.
Yeah.
I thought you meant for him to play. It's like,
No.
I don't know, man.
What else does he play, though? He plays Naga, but there's no way they do Naga here.
Please don't pick Naga here.
There's no way they pick Naga here. It would, I think, it massacred.
Yeah.
Okay, what else do we have for Loader?
Loader.
Hawk Band. Oh, there's still Lifestealer. I don't like Lifestealer at all versus Terrorblade.
And Lifestealer Wisp isn't the best. Is the Juggernaut still in the pool?
Juggernaut's still
in the
pool.
They could go Jug. He likes the Jug. Would it be a Luna?
Could be Luna. I've been liking Luna, but it's not your ideal relocate partner. I think they need some late game. So I think Gyro is
Medusa, dude.
Yeah, but Wisp Deuce is actually not that bad.
It's not a combo people ever think of, but they take the Ursa. After you just explained why Ursa's not good in this game.
No, it's very good versus Titan. It's just not good versus Terrorblade.
Yeah, but I'm more scared of the Terrorblade.
That's okay. I think they can end the game actually pretty early with this. Mm-hmm. Because they have very good Roche. And Virtus Pro, like, Terrorblade is not that great at fighting prior to, like, 15, I would say.
Who did they put on G here to go up against the DP? Invoker, maybe?
Invoker, I think, is too slow.
G Invoker?
This is going to be a very fast pace because Bulldog's not on not on a carry.
Like, TA?
No, TA gets mowed down by Batrider.
Invoker, alright.
I personally think it's going to be way too slow.
I mean, what could he have taken instead of the Invoker is really my question.
That's,
like, a good classic G hero that comes online. I mean...
Yeah, that's true. There
it's not like he's going to pick Shadow Fiend here or something. That would have been awful.
Yeah. Puck people don't like.
Does Puck really scale as poorly as people say he does? Because I think now, like, with Aghanims and all that stuff, it's still like he just doesn't do enough damage.
Just stand there if you get Eggs.
Yeah. Puck Venge, dude. Swap him out.
People do, like, Puck 4-staff.
Yeah, it's legit, dude.
It's all right.
With Ben, just a 4.5 second stun. Once those BKBs get down, Terrorblade's just standing there like, I can't do anything.
This is a different strat from Alliance, though, than we've seen. It's the Death Prophet is stable for them. The Ursa is something that they haven't turned to recently, but they're on Radiant, so I would say it's pretty risky.
All right, are we predicting here?
I'm going with Alliance.
Which
just because
team will win?
Virtus Pro is not in good shape.
First player to get 15 denies.
I would say G.
I was going to pick G also, but...
It's usually the mid laner.
This is really interesting. We're going to pick the exact same thing. First team to kill Roshan.
Oh, that's definitely Alliance for me. Ursa? Yeah.
Yeah.
Highest net worth at game end? Ooh, that's tough. I think the Alliance is going to win, so we have to pick one of the Alliance cores. Bulldog is not on a farmer, so I don't want to say Bulldog.
I'm thinking S4, honestly. S4 or Loda. I'm picking S4.
I'm picking S4. Actually, who do they give the Aegis to? Who do you think they're going to give the Aegis to?
Probably Loda.
Probably Loda.
I can just hear them arguing about who gets the Aegis and Loda being more serious about it and S4 eventually being like, you know what? I don't need an Aegis. I'm just not going to die. 30
seconds to battle. I think I might pick Ursa.
All right, do it up. Dude, I'm digging on this Invoker hair, dude. Look at this new Immortal hair. He looks like...
Dude, Kael'thas. That Immortal is awesome.
Look at you. He looks badass. This makes me want to learn how to play Invoker.
Okay, who'd you select for first player to get 15 denies?
We're
doing G?
Can't remember. Oh, that's this one. I did G, yeah.
Do I want to do G?
I almost chose S4. I feel bad that I didn't choose S4.
I'm going with Loda.
Okay, it could be Loda. Spice things up a little bit.
Yep.
Okay. Well, we missed all of the initial ward placements because we were busy doing the predictions, but hey, that's okay. We bought compendiums. So, Dire, I'll get a lane ward down in mid, and then I'm going to put the Plateau. This seems to be a really common warding spot now, the Plateau up at the Radiant Tier 1.
Yep.
I feel like I'm seeing this more and more. It's a good ward spot, though. It really gives you a lot of good intel. You can see rotations coming, all that kind of stuff.
More importantly, you can see them go Iron Talon jungle.
Oh, yeah. Alright, oh, this is the Squid Death Prophet, the bad character in The Little Mermaid. I don't like that cosmetic.
What's her name?
Much. Ursula?
Oh, yeah.
I think. Bulldog? Almost in trouble up top. Mystoscope, Firefly. Actually, this is a First Blood! Bulldog, hello! Easy money there for Aloha Dance. There you go.
Yeah.
Just a little too confident there.
I have never really been a fan of Bulldog's Batrider, but that's okay.
Are you just saying that because he fed first blood, or is that your honest opinion?
No. Well, during the Manila qualifiers, Mott asked me what I thought of his Batrider. I said it's better than Swindle's, but it's still not very good.
Oh, God. Savage. All right, so it is a straight dual lane mid here on both sides. S4 going to have the Whisplinger in around, and FNG stable is... What are you on about?
Oh, I was looking at top. They have a stack already, and they're taking it from VP's side. They're denying Bulldog a lot of experience, and he really wants a part of that stack, but he doesn't have any napalm, so he can't really do it. I think Bulldog's going to be in a fair amount of trouble this game as far as farm and net worth goes.
Yeah.
And they have a really... They're supposed to have a pretty fast-paced lineup, so if they don't have the blink dagger timing early, then they will not be able to relocate pressure.
Oh, what a cask. It almost goes back to EGM. He's going to have a tether up. FNG trying to find this kill. G nearby. Who's going to get it first? It's going to be VP. They'll trade one for one, though. Both supports fall, and now G going to be forced back after taking some damage from S4.
Oh, it's Quaswex Invoker.
Yeah.
Nice. Quaswex is really good versus the IO. I actually forgot about Quaswex. I was like, oh, Quaswex is going to be too slow, but if it's Quaswex, that is definitely the play.
So you see the relocates, can just drop EMP tornadoes.
It
the,
is
kind of the general
so good. Yeah. And
it's like, what's a Wisp without mana? Is that the theory?
What's an Ursa without mana? Yeah, and you can also just follow up with like Cask or Ravage. You can set up for like all these different spells.
Yeah, it's true. Well, even though the Batrider's not having the best time, the other lane's going pretty well for Alliance. Lota's just in complete free farm heaven. This lane is sacked. Yoku's just been straight jungling. Iron Talon level 1, level 3 on the Tidehunter. And mid lane, it's fairly even. S4 with a very slight edge, but not by much. G, come on, man. You got to start racking up those denies. What are you doing?
He's Quaswex. It's hard. He doesn't have that damage.
Chose the wrong one. S4, uh-oh. Cold Snap, cast. Maledict to follow up. This could be a potential kill here. He's going to get healed up. He's going to start taking a lot of damage from the curse. Now the Soul Siphon the other way. It's actually G that's getting low. Are they going to dive this for the kill? They will. It's EGM that gets credit for it. It's the old switcheroo, Merlini.
Very patient with the Wisp. This is one of the very difficult parts about playing Wisp in the early game. Like, you think you got to kill. Oh, wait, he's healed. Oh, wait, we used all our spell to try and burst her down. And then you just get turned around on. And it looks like that Invoker int nerf. Or mana nerf hurting him pretty badly. He didn't have enough mana to catch his EMP. Or sorry, his tornado. Oh,
that was the saddest tornado I think I've ever seen from G right there. He still falls though. That one last auto attack from the high ground gets him.
Nice.
A little vengeance the other way. 2-3. VP pull back into the lead.
Ursa just does not know the denying life. Come on, there's so many low creeps there, Lota. What the heck?
One deny. He's going to lose his creep.
He has the most free farm in the lane. Oh man, Loader.
So what happens if nobody gets 15 denies? Does everybody just lose? That wasn't an option. I think everybody should just default win. What do you get if you win these, by the way? Do I get, like, tokens or something?
I don't know.
I need to open my Immortals. I'm so far behind. Looks like some action could be brewing down bottom. No fear. Uh-oh, he gets hexed up. He's on the run. The follow-up stun from Ake and the two supports will yield a kill. Nice setup there from Alliance. Vengeful Spirit, just wrong place, wrong time.
Very nice.
Towers done.
Aggressive wards coming out from Alliance. They had that ward since the start. And this is the downside of having Iron Talon. You know, there's people like, why not Iron Talon every game? This is why. Your tower dies 4 minutes.
Yeah.
With a Basilius.
And you know it, too. It's the same thing with the Beastmaster in the jungle. Yes, he does come online and can hit a timing, but that window before he's level 6 is brutal. G mid lane. Speaking of brutality, EGM smacks him with the balls. And S4 just follows up with a Crypt Swarm. Very nice.
Easy.
Those EGM balls, they're huge.
In your face all the time. Aloha Dance, Freshness Tower, Bulldog. Ooh, going with the Windlace. Going with a new trend.
All right, so the drum rider.
Or even just casual Windlace. I still think you need the Blink Dagger. Or do you?
I don't know. I do like the drum build in some games. This one, I think just going for that good old-fashioned fast blink is their golden ticket.
I don't actually think so, because Quaswex Invoker owns the initiation. Tidehunter also owns the initiation. You can't jump on him, and Vengeful Swap.
S4 getting destroyed in the mid lane here. 3-on-1. Make it 4, actually, as Tide wanders his way over. Shares the Arcane Boots with the team. Nice easy gank rotation there. Pretty active early game from both teams. Oh, look at this. Loda and EGM smoke into the Roche pit. Uh-oh.
No, they're just going for the 6-minute rune. I don't know if he's going to check. Oh, he is, and he does have an invisibility rune. Oh, my goodness.
Dude, it doesn't get luckier than that. Oh, now he's going to cast. He might get this kill on EGM.
Wow.
It doesn't get luckier than that, I don't think.
And Elias just not really prepared. They did not have an Ops Ward over there. Luckily for them, Roche was not that low, so they will only get away with a Wisp kill. I'm surprised he didn't wait longer. Yeah. Imagine if he were more patient and Loda was low and Roche was low. Oh my, that would have been a game changer.
I mean, maybe he just didn't want to give it up, but a Witch Doctor off the map at this stage of the game is not suspicious at all for Alliance. They could have easily rotated over another hero and maybe gotten a kill on Loda. I'm actually a little surprised Loda's still going for this. Ake nearby is going to reveal himself, and now there's a big rotation, short-range tornado coming in. They are going to find the kill on Ake. Loda.
Just give up on the Roche, I think.
Yeah, he's already gotten out of dodge. It's definitely the right call. S4, he floats his way over with those little tentacles, but now they're just going to hand the Roche over. Down to about 2/3 HP. Not easy for VP to take either.
Time for Tidehunter to get involved. Tidehunter, where are you at, bro?
Do they commit an exorcism for this?
Okay, Tidehunter's here. He has Ravage. No. Tornado, EMP, like in this tight area is just devastating. Last time I saw Yoku on the Tidehunter, he just farmed like so often, so much, and did not use the Ravage at all. This game, I'm glad to see him get a little bit more involved. Radiant has used their scan. Both teams do have an Observer Ward up in that area. Smoke gank onto Loader.
Yep, they're thinking about it. The rotation from VP, are they going to find him? They might get S4 instead. He goes right down to the low ground, stung from the high ground. EGM comes cruising on him, but there's a Ravage ready and waiting. Two down on the side of Alliance, and now VP get the green light to head right into the Roche pit.
That was a great smoke gank from them. Easy peasy. Well, they do not want to give this up. Death Prophet, no buyback. This Roche is dropping really low. Ake wants to get a piece of that. And they have no fight in them.
Yeah, they really don't kill it quickly. Loda thinking about having a go, but doesn't have a blink dagger. No way to jump into the pit. Roche does go down to the Dire. Aloha Dance gets the Aegis. No fear. Pulled to the high ground. Bulldog will get a freebie on the Vengeful Spirit, but not the end of the world. All things considered, Virtus Pro pretty happy with an easy Roche and an Aegis now on their Terra Blade.
What a disaster. Oof.
Tough break for Alliance. That actually hands VP a pretty decent lead. Now the cast bouncing around. And so far, this Witch Doctor has been a pretty effective pick against the Wisp, I have to say.
That's great.
Uses the Exorcism here.
And now Invoker has kind of recovered from that terrible early game. Now he's 4-2-1. Pretty decent in terms of net worth, and Alliance will finally get that mid tower down. Yoku's burning down in the bottom lane. Bulldog very close to his blink dagger. This could be what they're looking for. They really need the level 6 on the Wisp, though.
And he's only level 4. Tomes of Knowledge coming out in about a minute's time.
Dude, Ursa's going to be in Strug City now.
Yeah. Experience is actually becoming the big bottleneck for Alliance. The Lion's not even level 6 either. He's at the very beginning of 5. So no Finger of Death. They really need that finger to follow up these lassos to get the kills.
They were banking on that Roche so hard.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Well, I guess that we all learned a lesson. Don't go into Roche before the 6-minute rune's going to spawn. At least see what the rune is first.
They didn't have vision. If they had vision, they would have been okay. They could have just killed him.
Yeah, yeah, you're right, actually. They would have seen exactly what happened.
That's a little bad timing from them and just good play by FNG running in there. As soon as you know Wisp is down.
The Dota gods blessing FNG with the perfect rune for the situation.
Yep.
Because if he got any other rune, maybe
Hasty would have been able to destroy them.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, Hasty would have checked the pit. Yeah, that's a good point. All right. Many of the other runes, he might not have been quite so manly there. There's the blink dagger on Bulldog.
That's a very good timing from Bulldog.
Yeah.
Despite his early bad start.
10 minutes, even without the Windlace, is good. So this is...
They're smoked up. FNG, Aloha Dance, and no fear. Looking at S4, S4 sensing out a smoke gank. Yeah, they know something's up.
Oh, they smoke themselves. S4, he's got himself the infused raindrops. Here we go. Blink lasso onto no fear. Cast, not going to take any bounces. But it's a lackluster lasso. Only gets the Venge down to about half HP. And that is the Blink Dagger reveal.
That was underwhelming.
Yoku with a Ravage. Yeah, not surprised they didn't commit more for that.
He couldn't bring them into his team because of the casks. So he kind of had to pull it to the left, and they just did not have enough damage to follow up. Well,
Aloha Dance, with Dragonlance complete, wailing away on that mid tower. As for thinking about it, deny.
Not gonna happen. It's Witch Doctor that gets credit for it. Meanwhile, G rotates up top, wants to set something up. Tornado misses EGM.
Wow, that dude, do you see the runes on the ground too? Like there's like inscriptions where he casts a tornado.
That's what that was.
That's
I saw the
gig.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool.
No, it just keeps getting better and better every time I see it. I'm like, dang, this is like
it
coolest
matches,
immortal.
It matches terribly. Swap. What do we got here? That's four. He's in a sticky wicket, and they've got more than enough damage to bring him down. It's a sad death profit.
Nice attempted save there by Bulldog with that pretty good flame break. However, they are just lacking on a lot of fronts. Loda kind of lost without an Aegis, as an Ursa should feel.
Yeah.
We didn't give VP enough credit.
I guess we are seeing kind of the weak side of the Ursa here. If you don't get the early game you're looking for with the Roche, you feel a little bit underwhelming. He's going for Mask of Madness.
That's a standard build.
Is it?
Yep. Do you not see Shanghai?
No.
Oh. Well, that's the common build.
Okay.
CTY kind of got it first, and everyone's like, oh, wow, this is pretty good.
It definitely... has
you
a
put
place.
G? Oh, you got G right.
Ooh.
Man, I blame Ursa for he had free farm. Where were the denies?
He's only got three,
oh,
dude. He was focused
God.
On the last hit. All 77 of them. He's number one.
I guess I expected Tyler to come in the lane, but then he Iron Talon. I need to see their starting items first before I do this.
Yeah, there you go. I guess the Mask of Madness, like
they're coming from behind, they have a blink on a Tidehunter, this could be big.
And they relocate out in time. EGM, Nobi's gonna head one way, and Lotus gonna go the other. All right. That was actually underwhelming. Thought VP get a little more there. Wisp. He still relocates out.
I mean, he's dead. Unless he tethers to the left, but
dude,
the creep weighs a little bit far.
Is he gonna be able to get it? I don't
Dire's
think so.
Middle tower is under attack.
Oh, he does tether, but it's not gonna matter. Well, at least EGM makes a little bit of space, Loader stays alive, and the rest of Alliance split push around the map. Not too bad, minimizing their losses.
Their lineup's not great for split pushing. You have an Ursa, a DP, and a Batrider as your cores, and you're forced to split push because you lost the early game and you are Alliance.
Yeah, they need to fight around this Lasso so much. Anytime they've got Lasso, Finger, Exorcism up, I think they need to be looking to pick a fight.
They can fight with Relocate. Just Lasso, Relocate into Ursa, but the problem is you don't have that many kills, and if they don't see the Venge, it could just be like swapping and just getting crushed by Ravage or something.
Yeah. So is Loda just grab Blink next for the Mask of Madness?
I think so.
I don't know what else you would want. You need some way to get into these fights and actually do damage. He's still 0-0-0. It's just been all farming for him so far.
I'm trying to think of any other build that would be okay for him, aside from a Blink Dagger. I think you have to go Blink.
Yeah.
He'll probably need a BKB at some point just because he has to deal with Tidehunter and Invoker. But I do not think you get that now.
No, I don't think so either. Yep, there's the blink. Okay, so pretty standard stuff.
Bulldog.
Smoke rotation from VP. Yeah, they might find Bulldog in the tree line here. He's got a Blink Dagger. They ping him out right away. The smoke gets broken. Venge scouts it. Not going to be able to blink. They'll swap him and it'll be an easy kill on the Bulldog. They knew exactly where he was.
Yep.
Can't teach an old dog new tricks.
They're getting owned now. This is not looking very good for Alliance at all.
Alliance fans around the world. Sad to see their...
Dude, VP really got their stuff together. They're like incorporating the Tidehunter to a lot more of these fights.
Yeah.
When I saw them at Frankfurt, they were just like... It was 4-1 all the time.
Oh, absolutely. They look way better than they were. EGM, tether away. Loda says, see you later, buddy. Good luck. I'm going to blink out.
Did you see the runes on the ground with the tornado?
Wow. Yeah, look at this sick invoker.
So cool.
The hair is so simple, but I still like it. It's like he's got dreads, but they're not dreads. He looks kind of like Arthas, actually.
He does look like Arthas. You're right.
I was reading one of the Warcraft books on the plane right here. I'm all up on that Warcraft lore.
No Fear walks into S4 and Ake.
Not the play here. He's got a TB nearby, but there's a lasso for him. They'll bring down No Fear first. Aloha Dance, soon to be in some trouble. He does have friends on the way. There's Yoku with a Ravage on three. Follow-up cast. They're going to turn this one around. It's a shake and bake, and Alliance aren't having it. Finger of Death from Lion helps set it up. It ends up being a chaotic fight, and for now, Alliance are finding the advantage. Yoku pushed back by the Exorcism. It'll be a 2-for-4 when it's all said and done, and Voker the only one not joining the party. Big fight for Alliance. They get a 2,300 net worth exchange out of it.
That was great. No Invoker there to the setup. That would have really helped them out, but I don't think that VP expected that like so many people right there. They timed that Wisp death really well, because you're like, okay, Wisp is dead, we can play great for a little bit, and then they just got slaughtered at their Ancients.
Yeah. I don't think they were ready for an Exorcism to be deployed there. I think they were just hoping a Ravage would be enough to turn it around, pick up a couple kills, and then all of a sudden, was literally the entire team. And I guess not too surprising G didn't show up. He's going for an Orchid. One of the kind of classic items.
Surprisingly he didn't show up? I think it's actually surprising he didn't show up because he's caused Wex.
Well, I think he needs to finish his item. I think he's looking at this Orchid timing. We're already 16 minutes in. He's sort of close, but still needs a recipe. I think he just needs a little me time to get it finished up.
I think if he had a Tornado, though, the whole team can just bounce. Like, Tornado is really good this early.
It would have been good if he was there, but I understand why, like, of all the timings for him to be farming, this is a pretty key, like, the longer you delay the Orchid, the more you limit your, you know, what you can do. But this is the point where he wants to be able to go hunt, destroy that Wisp.
But it's not worth it. They gave up a big lead because and their Terrorblade died, which is their highest net worth at this point. Like, he was pretty close to surviving because he got the Sunner off, and then they just didn't have enough follow-up because they kept getting chased down by Spirit Siphon. If you have, like, one break on the Spirit Siphon, you can reset the fight, and realizing that, okay, they don't have vision over there, and Alliance does, and take the fight in a better place, then they'd be in a much better situation. But Alliance getting back in the game.
I wonder what those runes say. Are they just made-up runes?
I think they're just made-up runes.
Damn it. Looking for a deeper meaning in life, Merlini. It must be in those runes.
You can make stuff up.
Whatever helps you sleep better at night. Oh, Terrorblade. What a hero.
With the first Roshan kill. Incorrect. First player to get 15 denies. Incorrect. Okay. I have two left.
Alright, I got one. I got one correct. If Alliance wins, I'll be in pretty good shape. Highest net worth at the end of the game. I picked S4, you picked Loda. Oh, no, I picked S4.
I picked Loda.
You picked Loda? Okay.
You are. I don't think you're
winning
that
one. Things are going to have to change quite a bit for that to be the case. We're going to see a 5-0 smoke now out of Alliance. Bulldog in the front lines. Looking for a Roche, possibly. Is it up? Yeah, sure is.
Where is Dire Smoke? Do they not have any smokes? They do not. This is going to be mega awkward. Just casually walking down.
At least Alliance don't commit to the Roche pit this time.
Yeah, that would have been a disaster. They just need to pick off with Bat. Yoku sitting pretty far in the back. Newly acquired Orchid. That could actually be very problematic for Ursa.
There's also a mech now on the Tidehunter. Still no mech for the Radiant.
That's all good. You have Wisp.
Yeah. BKB on the way for Loda coming up next. 1,000 gold off.
VP need to ensure that the Terrorblade survives. He's like their main damage dealer. Coswex is just there for the control to stop Ursa from doing his thing, counter-initiate on Batrider, kite the Death Prophet, but the real damage dealer is Alliance. He needs to stay alive. Defensive swap so he can get off his Sunder, like Ravage to save him. They need to make sure that these spells go off in the fight so that VP can win it. Alliance, I don't exactly know how to initiate the fight, because if Bulldog doesn't initiate on the Venge, they get a defensive swap. If he initiates on Tidehunter, they just get destroyed. But if he doesn't go in, you have like a Death Prophet kind of just running in there, so it's not a great fight for them. I think he just blinks in there and gets vision and then deals with Lasso later.
Yeah, you need a silence from S4, I think. I hear the Lasso on the back line. Bulldog goes in deep. It's S4 that gets isolated, though, doing pretty good damage to BP. What a beautiful relocate. Keeps him safe from the Ravager, at least for a little bit of time. S4 getting so low, but he will survive through it. Invoker did die. He's bought back instantly, and BP are starting to get cleaned up. This is Alliance's fight, and a lot of it because of the EGM relocate. Aloha Dance has already used his Sunder. Well, a few more auto attacks will bring him down. Bulldog committing deep. He's going to get it, but whoo, that was close. One more, and he would have fallen. It's a 4-for-0, and they force a buyback on the Invoker. A huge fight for Alliance. 3,600 net worth exchange. They're going to move right into the Roche pit.
Wow, that was one of the best relocates I've seen in a while. He saved them from the solo Ravage on the Tide.
Yeah, that was, and it was like last second. The timing on that was insane. S4 actually still got stunned by the Ravage, but it just pulled them into a far enough position they couldn't really capitalize on it.
Yep.
Ake pushing back G, this will be a Roche for Alliance. Honestly, that was one of those plays that happened so fast, you couldn't even really catch how clutch it was from EGM. That's like a highlight reel slow motion kind of play, and that is... There's a reason this guy's won a TI before, man. What a player.
What a player indeed. And Bulldog setting it up, all just causing chaos inside the pit. Ursa cleaning up. Now they are very healthily in the lead. Hairblade, his thunder was... He got like 300 HP from that, but he didn't really have a choice at that point.
I didn't even see it in all the chaos. I just saw it was on cooldown at the end when he needed it. It's a hard spell to try to use because you don't want to save it too long, but...
It made it a lot better, though.
You need to use it at some point, yeah.
It's super long range.
It's still just a weird... I just don't understand how it synergizes with the rest of what Terrorblade does. I know he's notorious for being that hero that's been reworked a bunch of times, but it just... His other spells kind of make sense. And then...
Okay.
Oh, I'll just swap your HP. Sick.
Well, I'll just read this flavor text. You didn't need that life, did you? The Demon Marauder steals that which you hold most dear.
Well...
Makes sense now, Andrew.
When you put it that way, it all makes sense. You know, speaking of Warcraft lore, Illidan, the Sundering, right? That's why it's Sunder, because he's based on...
Now you know. Now you know.
Now Grand Grant, man, he opened my eyes to the history
what
of...
Was his, what was his name in Dota 1? Terror, like, Terrorblade the...
Escaped.
Or was he ill? I'm gonna look this up.
Yeah.
This is bothering me.
Well, Ake's gonna die. That's alright. Oh, maybe not. Force staff back. Bulldog with a lasso. Now the relocate in. The BKB loader's here. He's going hard on the No Fear, and that'll finish off the Vengeful Spirit. Now Aloha Dance on the run. Meanwhile, on the other side of the fight, G getting pushed back hard. He's got the Exorcism on, but they're gonna find the kill. Bulldog dives him deep, and this... really spread out fight is going to benefit Alliance a lot. They get a 2 for nil.
Death Prophet's just running at them. Aloha Dance.
Yeah.
Does have Thunder up.
Oh, he gets it off too.
Doesn't
Why
matter.
Is he in so deep? Yeah, the Witch Doctor falls. I thought DP were just going to get out of there. Ravage actually brings him low. Aloha Dance almost turns it around. Loader with 20 HP. Perlini, that was such a weird team fight. It ends up a 4 for nil. Vastly in favor of Alliance.
Terrorblade was just in a weird position where he was isolated from his team, and Tidehunter wasn't that close.
That wasn't even a team fight. It was like three mini skirmishes that all broke out, and Alliance just... They had the numbers advantage in all of them, it felt like.
They do not have a solution to Death Prophet just running in. That's
yeah.
What S4 is doing. He's just spear diving people, running in, relying on EGM to heal him, and they don't want to blow Ravage on him because they saw what happened last time, but they actually cannot deal with Death Prophet.
Dude, watching that fight, it was like the Invoker didn't know what to do. Literally, DP just charged him, and he pretty much died. I mean, all he has is Orchid Midas. He's not very beefy right now, and outside of Ghostwalk, he's not very survivable.
I still think that last time when he was farming up his Orchid and then he didn't fight his team, help his team right there, that was the moment where BP lost a lot of this game.
Yeah, look at that gold graph. That, oh my god.
That was a very important time for him to be with his team. And BP, they've lacked chemistry for some time now.
Yeah, we were talking about this on the panel earlier, and it seems like when everything's going according to plan, now we're going to see Bulldog get picked off here, it looks like. Yep, Sun from the bench, going to make it nice and easy. Almost gets denied by the Hadouken, actually. It was pretty close. It seems like they draft with a game plan, and when everything's going according to plan, they look good. But once it starts to fray, once there's that one misplay, once the enemy throws a screw into the mix, that's where they start to fall apart, you know? And you're right, you go back to that one play, and ever since then, it's like VP haven't been on the same page. Before that, they looked pretty good.
They did. They had Aegis. They denied so much of what Alliance needed in the early game. But their team fight was like way stronger at that point too. They had Ravage. Like Yoku was extremely farmed. They had Qualisblex Invoker with Midas, like who struggled early but then got back in the game. And then like you lose a 4-for-1 like that. Oh, FNG gets fingered.
Alright, he gets peeled up, compliments to the mech, but now the ult from S4 comes out, and look at his positioning, he just charges him. EMP does do some work, now Loda reinitiates with the BKB on, they drop the Witch Doctor straight away, S4 gets low, and he does fall. Tidehunter getting credit for that one, it's already a 2-for-1, TB at about half health, no Sunder available.
Wow, that was so close, he tried to use himself to dodge a Sunder, but he got it off right before.
Oh yeah, here we go. Yoku getting low. Now Ake blinking forward. The Batrider about to join the party. They're gonna catch G. He comes in, grabs Aloha Dance. Nothing the Terrorblade can do. The initial part of that fight was actually a 4v5 without Bulldog. Once he joined up, everything got a lot easier. One left alive for VP, but it looks like not for long. Yoku caught by the flame break, and Loda will dive to finish him off. It's a triple kill and a complete team wipe as Alliance now move up to the high ground and start working on this tier 3.
I guess you can have as many whiffs countered as you want, but they still cannot handle. Let's see, they play the whiffs so differently every time too. It's not like, okay, we're gonna relocate on Wisp or with Wisp and just kill people. They're using it just as making the Death Prophet almost impossible to kill. Like, if they didn't get that Thunder off, Death Prophet would not have died that last fight. And
even that was a close call.
Yeah,
even
that was a super close call. And S4, he's just enabled so much by EGM's Wisp this game that everything just falls into place.
Yeah.
It's,
what the heck?
Crazy. It's pretty insane. Alright, let's see here. S4 now. Hey, he's picked up a Rod of Atos and now a Plate Mail. I haven't been paying too much attention to his item progression, but don't see Atos all that much. I do like it on DP though. It has some natural synergy. Of course, she loves both those stats, the int and the HP, but the cripple's pretty good.
I think this makes the Invoker like super useless. You would just cripple him, Spirit Siphon, just run on top of him. And
what
then...
what does he do? Maybe he ghost walks. That's about it.
And he ghost walks, you're definitely dead.
Yeah, that's...
You have to hit like a really good tornado, but...
Man, you were really hyping up that Quaswex Invoker this game.
Well, I really disliked the Invoker pick. I was like, oh god, VP already lost. And then they're like, Quaswex. I was like, oh, okay, that's salvageable. And then he wasn't there for that one important fight, and like he farmed his Orchid, but what has Orchid done this game for him?
Absolutely nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
Orchid's incredible on Quaswex Invoker when you're ahead and you can be the aggressor. When you're in the enemy jungle, the enemy supports are like on the back foot and you can find those solo kills. When you can't do that, when you're on the back foot, it feels like a very underwhelming item. Like, it sure, it still has some utility, but what difference does the silence make once they already get initiated on?
And once Loda has BKB and Aegis and all this other stuff that they shouldn't have had to begin with.
And Loda's got a basher now. Maybe you can use it to silence the Wisp so we can't relocate, save somebody. But
impossible.
Even that's difficult because Wisp is going to be sitting far back. And, you know, you're not going to be able to catch the Bat Rider. He's going to blink Lasso right away. It only works if you're the one that's initiating and starting these fights. And VP just have not been in that position.
Yeah, I liked it at the time, but they... As you said, it's much better when you're ahead, and they were kind of ahead up until he actually got it. So
yeah.
it would have been okay. I guess if he expected to be in this sword business, he would have just went Scepter or something in transition.
Right. Now, I see what you mean. At the time that he picked it up, they were actually kind of winning. They had stopped the Roche, and it looked like he might be able to take control. So
yeah. The thought process. I don't blame him for it. It's just it was a really unfortunate series of events.
Yeah. Here we go. Initiation on Loda down bottom, perhaps?
No. Yeah, he has BKB.
Well, they just swapped him. They say yes, Merlini. BKB gets used. So does the Enrage. How's this fight going to go? Aloha Dance caught by the Lasso. S4 joins the party. We move into some lag. And the Terra Blade's just dead. An ambitious play from Virtus Pro. Now they're just dropping like flies. They'll lose FNG. No fear. It's a quick 3-0 just like that. The rest of them in full retreat. G in Ghostwalk form. He'll make it out. Yoku, he's slowed up by the big bad bat. And that Rod of Atos coming in handy. It will be a 4-0. Well, I guess Coach Merlini called it right, a fight they shouldn't have taken, but VP
definitely do not go in the Ursa there.
We're pretty bold
definitely
about that one.
That's
what was the game plan there? Like,
desperate, hoping that no one was behind them.
Yeah, I guess that's it. But if you look at Dire Vision, they've got some wards in the jungle, but they couldn't see behind
they're
the tree line,
like,
so they didn't know what was there.
I think their morale is beaten.
Was that just the YOLO smoke? Like, well, we might as well try something, guys. We lost anyway.
They want to make a play before the next Aegis, because they know if they don't take that, they will definitely lose. So,
okay.
They didn't stand a chance, though, honestly, that fight. As soon as they lasso Loda, he popped his Enrage, it was over.
Yeah.
It's okay.
I mean, they didn't even come close to killing him either.
At least they tried. I admire that more than sitting back in your base and turtling.
Okay, yeah, no, I'm of the same mindset. It looks like a worse play than it is, because the alternative is just sit there passively and let Alliance get further and further.
You're hoping that no one's behind them, but even if no one's behind them, it's still a very difficult kill.
I mean, as you get progressively further behind in a game, your tolerance for risk has to go up, basically.
Well, they could have done a smoke around the bottom, behind the T2.
You mean like wrap around, kind of like this way?
Because that's where the supports are sitting.
Okay.
So if you think the supports are sitting behind, you wrap around. If you think that he's alone, then you go on him. I think they just assumed that he was alone, that he was alone.
Look at this VP positioning right now. If you look at their wards, they just have like this. They own this area of the map right here. That's all VP. They're looking for kills. They're looking to hunt.
That's their last play. It's smoke into the opponent jungle, get a pick, get roast, and then get back into the game.
Yeah.
So set up wards.
I mean, I like it, though. This necessary. Is, like, what they have to do. They're taking risk.
Yeah, you can tell that they have good ideas. It's just some of their execution and stuff is just not that great.
Alliance getting a little vision control here. They do have a gem on the Batrider. They are going to start clearing out these wards. Loda loses his blink. Yoku on the way in, thinking about a gush.
Nah. Loda's in front. His position is really, really good for these fights. They cannot bypass him to get to the squishy targets. You want to kill Aki, you want to kill EGM.
Yeah.
You can deal with the last look because you have Swap and Sunder, but...
Uh-oh. BKB Bulldog, he goes cruising on in. Lasso grabs No Fear. They take the Venge out to start the fight. Aloha Dance gets left behind, and G, he gets caught by the Abyssal Blade on the backside. Ravage from Yoku helps break it up a little bit. It does get the kill on EGM, but it's not going to be enough to save his team. They've lost their supports, and they are just dropping like flies. Invoker barely limps away in Ghostwalk. EGM buys back. Loda is just on a complete tirade right now. 11-0-6. They're going to move into the Rosh Pit, and this should be yet another Roshan for Alliance. Because of the buyback, they don't get a huge net worth gain, but this is their game, baby.
That was another hopeful, hey, maybe they won't expect us to Rosh.
I didn't expect them to Rosh. That's true. It's unpredictable.
Unpredictable. Sometimes the crazy play is the best play.
Yeah.
Because there's no losing more. It's just you lose. Now they're going to lose more because of that, but who cares? Because they try to win. I'm down with that. I'm totally down with you, VP.
Yeah.
You guys lost, but that's okay.
Dude, they go out like fighters. They don't do any of this. We lost a fight, GG, before you get to the base. They go for that last-ditch effort. They go for the YOLO Ravage, even if it doesn't work. Runes come flying in the tornado. Mid lane of barracks. About to be turned to rubble here. Alliance with the right clicks. They will secure the melee barracks. Range shortly after. VP, well, pretty light on buybacks here, though they do have one or two available. Alliance not going to get cocky. They will just back out after finding the barracks skills. They've got all of their ultimates except the exorcism coming up in about 60 seconds, but similar timing to the Ravage. So okay. If they want to pick a fight, they might be able to.
So what can VP do right now? They could sit in base. But
Smoke of Deceit, stock one.
Do they have it?
Yes.
Oh, stock one.
Yes.
This is where they make the last. No, I don't know.
Come on, VP. This is you.
It's completely crazy to fight into an Aegis cheese, but VP might just be crazy enough to do it.
I mean, this game is really looking rocky for them, though. It's looking very dark at this point. I don't want to try out a hero build. Please go away.
How big of a bang can you go out with, VP?
Maybe they can at least kill Loda. Loda still hasn't died yet this game.
No, you
11-0-6.
You can't
they
kill
tried
Loda
it
here.
Before. It didn't work. Second
Look at
time.
His items, dude. Even without a wisp in the game, they can't do it.
Even without the Aegis, they probably can't
do it. Yeah.
Killing him twice, that's going to be something.
BKB just owns everything that they have. They have no instant disable.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. I mean, they could swap him into tier 4s.
No, he has enrage.
I mean, what do you want me to say? They lost? Come on, man.
They did lose. They have lost. I want to see them go out with a bang, though.
All right. Well, they could get a 6 Sunder. Another cool Sunder on the BP on the DP could be good. BP on DP. All right. Look at it go. EMP, Cask bouncing around. There is no Glyph for Virtus Pro. 20 seconds till that bad boy comes back up. Loda just going up on the high ground. He takes the Orchid. It hurts. It tickles. He's okay.
Oh, they passed the cheese to Wisp. There is... Oh my goodness, they have to kill Wisp.
And he has a mech now, too. Dude, the amount of healing he can put into Loda is actually insane. Cask? Oh.
Don't act like you're scared for Ursa's life.
Dude, I thought that was going to start bouncing back and forth and they were going to go for it. That was the opening right there, but... Good positioning from Ake. Only takes one bounce. Tornado? Off the mark. Oh, this is an anticlimactic slow siege here.
Well, I expect the VP to make a YOLO play, because I think they have to make a YOLO play.
I mean, Alliance are playing this so cautious, so smart.
They have a lot of time to do so.
Yeah. Man, there's a lot on the line here. Oh my god, right in onto G. Nice swap back from No Fear. Lotus already used his BKB, now Bulldog joins the party. No Fear, caught by the lasso, pulled right into enemy territory. Ake actually gets destroyed by Aloha Dance. They trade one for one in terms of support, but the tier 3 tower's already gone down. Yoku with the ultimate, the Ravage actually does some okay damage here. Loda's out of mana, but don't forget, he's got the agent. S4 getting low, but don't worry, EGM's got him tethered up. He's already fed the cheese over. Loda getting low, S4, these ghosts are doing a lot of damage here, Merlini. G overcommits outside of the base, he falls. They kill the Ursa for the first time, but it costs them everything. FNG trying to make it back, but the Soul Siphon slowing him down. No fear from the grave. Taps out. GG, well played. 34-18. It's Alliance coming out big. 13-0-8 on Lotus Ursa.
Which team will win? How did I get result none? What the heck?
Wait. Yeah, what the hell is that?
I don't know.
Nobody won.
Dota 2 sometimes.
Shenanigans. Well,
EP not looking in good shape. Their top three hopes are kind of dashed at this point, if that's the sort of fight that they put up versus a team like Alliance. Alliance, a little bit of a shame.